It's been just about 2 weeks since word broke of cyber criminals hacking into Sony Pictures, and each day seems to bring more damaging, embarrassing, or worrisome revelations. The hackers have released a steady flow of information, ranging from salaries to personal emails, social security numbers, and health records of employees, to internal messages showcasing industry hardball. The past couple of days have been even worse for the company, if you can believe that. And again to Hari, who's in our New York studios tonight.
The latest emails put new pressure on Amy Pascal, the co-chair of Sony Entertainment and one of the most powerful executives in Hollywood. It's focused on confidential emails between Pascal and Scott Rudin, a powerful producer, before a fundraiser for President Obama. They exchanged messages in which they try to guess the president's favorite movies, all with African Americans. Pascal writes, "Should I ask him if he liked Django?" referring to Django Unchained. Rudin writes back, "12 years, for 12 years a slave." Pascal responds, "Or The Butler? Or Think Like a Man?" Both apologized yesterday. It's not yet clear who's behind the hacking, but they call themselves the Guardians of Peace. We turn to two watching this closely, Sharon Waxman, editor-in-chief of The Wrap, an industry news site, and James Lewis, a cybersecurity expert at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Sharon, I want to start with you. You're one of the few people to get in touch with Ms. Pascal yesterday. How significant is this hack? Put this in perspective. Is this what folks in Tinseltown are all talking about right now?
It's the only thing people are talking about, and it's by far the most significant thing to happen in the business this year, for sure, and probably will weigh on people's minds for years to come, largely because the studio has been more or less paralyzed for weeks now. I don't think that the studio is back to normal. From what we hear, they're doing billing by hand. Yesterday, we broke a story that the hackers once again penetrated their network and flashed a message on their computer screens, threatening to do more damage if their demands weren't met. That being said, their demands are not at all clear. But I think every single studio in town is checking their own security. And everyone is worried about their emails because, of course, anyone who's had contact with Sony's email system, which is everyone, is worried that they might be impacted as well.
Jim Lewis, this isn't your normal kind of hack in the sense that if somebody was able to get something as sensitive as social security numbers, you see that being sold on the darker portions of the internet. Tell us how this is different.
Well, it's different in a couple ways. The first is that there doesn't appear to be a commercial motive. It's some kind of political motive, maybe a personal motive. The second is that it's been going on for a long time. Most crimes are smash and grabs. You get in, you get the data, you sell it. And finally, this is a little more sophisticated than some of the things we've seen. It tracks very closely with what North Korea has done in the past, but it's in no way conclusive. And the North Koreans have never before gone after an American target. So in many ways, this is a bigger deal than what we've seen previously.
Sharon, help me understand, does this change how actors and agencies and studios do business in the sense that if I read through some of this, I know what actors make, what sorts of perks are included in the deals that are going on behind closed doors? And also, you get a sense that, there's this disturbing data that confirm the gender disparity that exists at the top of Hollywood.
Well, the gender disparity, which, by the way, is also an ethnic disparity, is not news to anybody who's involved in the entertainment industry. It's heavily white and it's heavily male. And Amy Pascal is one of the a handful of extremely powerful women executives in town. But if you're referring to the fact that the top million-dollar-plus salaries were released and pretty much she was the only one on that list who was a woman, yes, I think it underlines that. But it's way more disturbing in terms of doing business to, yes, what you're referring to, having conclusive information about what perks every star who's working at Sony gets, what stars are actually making. Within the, private negotiations that go on for various projects, people have actors, they have fees, and they have agents. But, of course, what is said and what is actually concluded is that there's always that murky space. That's all been ripped away with the revelation of these emails. And it's just one thing after another that is, embarrassing and that is going to make it difficult, I think, for Sony to be regarded as a place where you can do your business and that it remains private. You know, I think that is one part of the damage to the studio. And I also think that the damage to Amy Pascal personally, because this seems like a very personal attack on her, is devastating.
Jim, what do we know about the identities of the hackers? What sort of clues are the investigators working with?
Well, they're working with the code, which includes some Korean language that points towards North Korea. They're looking at the malware, which is similar to what North Korea has used in the past against South Korean targets, although it's been used by the Iranians and others in their cyber incidents. We're looking at the motivations and the statements. The North Koreans denied it. That doesn't mean anything. Everybody always denies covert action. What's interesting is that they also turned around and then said, wasn't us, but by the way, we're really glad to see this happen. It's interesting to note that this summer, the North Koreans sent a letter to the Secretary of the General UN protesting the film, asking that it be banned, and using language that was very similar to what we've seen in the hack. So in no way is this conclusive, but they're the lead suspect.
All right, Sharon, does this also fuel this tension between artists and the studios in the sense that when you read some of these emails, regardless of the race of the artist, they seem to be expressing on Twitter and other places that, you know what, we're the help. We make all this money for the studios, but this is what they really think of us behind closed doors.
It's really funny you say that because I've had a couple of calls this year completely unrelated to this, from people who are directors and who represent actors, saying exactly that there is so much more of like a surf landlord feeling in the culture of Hollywood today, and actually asking me to find out, if I could, who's making $1 million or more at the studios as they grind down constantly the salaries of the actors, who are the names that they open these movies with. But you have situations, and I don't know if you've seen, it's up on Twitter, Angelina Jolie, who is part of, who was mentioned in these emails between Amy Pascal and Scott Rudin, a very powerful producer, he was insulting to her in the emails, and she's obviously a director now, she has a movie coming out shortly, Unbroken, and they're talking about her in relation to interrupting some negotiations over a movie they're trying to make about Steve Jobs, and he refers to her as a spoiled brat. So just so happens, she was at a breakfast with Amy Pascal, and there is a pretty icy photo of the two of them greeting each other. So if you're asking about how it affects talent relations, and Amy Pascal is known as somebody who has warm relations with talent. That's one of the big important things. This is a business of relationships.
Right.
And that's, I think that makes everything kind of fraught at the moment, for sure.
All right. Sharon Waxman from The Wrap, Jim Lewis from the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Thanks so much.
Thank you.